الحمد لله، نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جزيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته، وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه، وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم أمين. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to brag about the qualities of certain Sahaba because of either their courage or the depth of their faith or how good they are with the Quran, or particularly their quality in dealing with fiqh issues. So he highlighted some names and tags. So Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu arda was highly commended for his courage. In the fights, there is no one who would want to stand in front of Ali. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu arda was known for generosity and tolerance and flexibility and mercy. Umar ibn al-Khattab was known as the man for the truth, radiallahu anhu arda. When you want somebody to stand for truth and for justice, Umar is there for it. Ibn Abbas was commended for his fiqh. Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha was highly commended for her fiqh and understanding. So much so that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would tell the companions of the Prophet, whoever they are, خُذُوا نِصْفَ دِينِكُمْ عَنْ هَذِهِ الْحُمَيْرَةِ. Take the half of your deen from this reddish lady, meaning Aisha radiallahu anha, who was known for being red-faced. So Zayd is well known for the Quran and how it became his life. And many, many other Sahaba, Khalid ibn al-Walid, later on when he became a Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called him Sayfullah al-Maslul, the drawn sword of God. So as we are continuing to talk about raising the great Muslim generation we needed to know how those Sahaba became who they are and how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commended each one of them for the qualities they were best at. And this drew my attention to something very important. We don't want all of our kids to be everything for every situation. We need some of them to be very good at something. We need every one of them to be very good at something. Something that is necessary and needed. Our kids, all of them, are good with electronics. They know your phones more than you do. From second year forward, they know everything. And we need to wean them off of what is luxury and pleasure and bring them on to what is serious and beneficial. This is how our ummah will change. Our ummah will not change because 10 kids memorize the Quran. But we need those memorizers. Our ummah is not going to be the greatest ummah if we have the 10 top physicists in the world. But we need those physicists. We need the doctors, we need the physicians, we need the inventors, we need the people with engineering skills and everything. But everybody has to know their deen. This is what is common. So if we want a blanket act that we need to do to make sure that our children will be not only a different generation, but a better generation, we must teach them Islam, all of them, all at once. Otherwise, they will excel in what they like, whether or not our ummah needs it. So how does a pelerina help our ummah? How does a singer help our ummah? You know Hassan ibn Thabit, that everybody is using to say he was kind of like a nasheed person? He was a mujahid. He was a mujahid. So writing poetry was only something on the side. Now, unfortunately, we turned artwork into an Islamic profession. It needs not to be. It needs to be something on the side. And we need to work on what matters, what brings power to our ummah, what brings our abilities as an ummah to push back against the assault on our ummah, east and west, north and south. We need to be able to push back. And without strong young men and women, and by strong, we mean strength of faith that will control how they think and how they make decisions, how they pick choices, how they pick a husband or wife, how they pick a profession that helps the Muslim community and the nation in which they live. This is how we should plan. This is how we should plan. What we are doing is, unfortunately, we are playing to the lower common denominator among our children. All of children want to play all the time. So let us give them play. And then one day they will pick Islam. No, one day they will be a good player. But having them play is not going to make them the greatest Muslims you want. You're not going to raise their potential and let them achieve their potential by only giving them what they ask for. They ask for what is fun and what is pleasant. Our responsibility is to bargain with what they want for what they need to learn and do. I will repeat this again. Use what they want, what they like, to bargain with them to make them do what they need to do and to learn. In other words, if your child is attracted to anything, let's say basketball, football, whatever, tell them, okay, take you to the basketball match, we'll take you to the training, but you have to keep up with your prayer. You have to learn some Quran. And the more you do with your duties, the more you get of pleasant things that you like to do. There's nothing wrong with playing basketball until it becomes a profession, which it's not. It is not. In my list of professions, being a player of anything is not a profession. Nobody's asking why. Because there are professional basketball players and other players, right? Those are people whose skills are used to distract people from serious stuff to do. Serious stuff needs serious communities, serious societies. Nations who want to build responsible citizenry, responsible citizens, they focus on education, they focus on healthcare, they focus on economic opportunity, they focus on raising talents. That's what serious nations do. The talent capital in the West now can overwhelm the entire world 10 times over. Where is our capital talent in our Muslim ummah? How many people could do what? So by ratio, we are way behind. And this is why the West is seizing this opportunity, to get more and total control over our resources, our ummah, our faith, our destiny. You see what's going on now in Palestine. And it's just one example. I'm not saying it's the only cause. There are so many other similar places. But Palestine has been there for history, over 60 some years. What's going on in Palestine now is what they call the final status resolution. And it is not a resolution at all. And it is not peaceful at all. It is as racist as it can get. A Jewish state and a no Palestinian state. We used to fear that one day they will give the Palestinians a fragmented state. But they will give the Palestinians no state, period. It has been declared by many people, responsible positions, saying there is no such a thing as a Palestinian state, and there was never a Palestinian state. The late, the prime Israel, the Israeli prime minister, former, Golda Meir. Golda Meir has a very beautiful argument. She says, I am a Palestinian. I carried a Palestinian passport since the early 30s. So when they want to have a Palestinian state, I am the Palestinian state. And my fellow Jewish people are the Palestinian state. What is the problem with that? She has an argument. She did have a Palestinian passport. What's wrong is her state canceled the presence of something called Palestine. And she has no qualm with this except to claim it for convenience. And our people are clamoring to give their support to whatever Israeli project there is or American project that is suggested. I believe if we were not broken, nobody will vandalize the store. But the store has been broken. Our system has been broken. As Muslims, we left Islam long time ago. As far as practicing Islam, we limited it to prayer. And by the way, this has been told to us more than 1400 years ago by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, لَتَنْقُضُنَّ عُرَى الْإِسْلَامِ عُرْوَةً عُرْوَةً. Look at me. This is نَقْضُ عُرَى الْإِسْلَامِ. You will unbutton the buttons of Islam one after another. The first is أَوَّلُهَا الْحُكْمُ. To use Islam as a source of guidance for governance. وَآخِرُهَا الصَّلَاةِ. Now, if you find a Muslim who keeps up with 5 times daily prayers, you have found a treasure that you will be proud to say, that's my son-in-law, that's my prospect son-in-law, that's my prospect daughter-in-law, she prays. When you find a girl that wears a headscarf, I'm not going to say hijab, a headscarf, you will praise her as if she is one of the Sahaba, one of the early generation of Sahaba. So the hadith of the Prophet, لَتَنْقُضُنَّ عُرَى الْإِسْلَامِ عُرْوَةً عُرْوَةً أَوَّلُهَا الْحُكْمُ وَآخِرُهَا الصَّلَاةِ. We are at the tail end of what this hadith is talking about. We are unbuttoning the last button. And this is the last button. If you unbutton, then you're bare. You're exposed. And because definitely when we do not govern according to Islamic rule, we do not live according to Islam. So what happens as a result? There is no collection of zakah. There is no distribution of zakah. So our nations became poor, and our poor became sicker and poorer, because we do not practice even the bare-bone minimum pillars of Islam. So if the pillars of this building are not standing, how could this building stand? It cannot. So when we say we want our kids to pray, we are barely talking about the bare bone minimum. We are talking about the basics of the basics. So we need to upgrade our understanding and our views of Islam to expand to the rest of what Islam is about. Islam is as much about Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi anil Munkar as it is about prayer. Islam is as much about fighting against those who fight you for your deen as much as it is about being merciful to the whole of humanity. It is both. There is no contradiction. There is no contradiction. You give mercy when there is no fight. Nobody is attacking you. Nobody is grabbing your land or stealing your resources, or they are enslaving your women or killing them and your children. Of course, you have to treat them well. The Quran says so. But if someone is fighting your nation to demolish it, you must stand tall. Where do we teach this to our children if all what we are struggling in our life with our children and for our children to do is just pray? When do they even learn the Quran that they memorize some of? When? When do they practice it? How do they understand it? How do they become leaders if all what they are seeking, like many of their parents, is just to be left alone, to be acceptable, or to be accepted? We have to go beyond the lame duck expectations. We are not here waiting to be slaughtered. We should never be like lame lambs who have no power to push back against anything. And if our children are raised to be like us, there is no great generation to talk about. We are not a great generation. The maximum we have done over 50, 60 years being here in this country is build a school, build a mosque. Are our mosques doing well? God knows. Are our schools doing the job they are assigned to do? God knows. Everything is up in the air. Are we improving? God knows. Are we even engaged? God knows. Are we volunteering? God knows. Are we even asking questions? God knows. It doesn't mean that we don't know. We know the answer. Those are rhetorical questions that everybody knows what the answer is. So if our expectations, if our plans and our achievements are so limited in scope, how could we raise a better generation? In fact, we are lowering their own views of what Islam is about. The maximum a child of ours will remember when they grow up is, I used to go to something, they used to call it the prayer, the mosque, the Quran, something like this. Unless our expectations are upgraded, our achievements will never be upgraded. I'm not talking to you to make you feel bad. I'm talking to you to inspire everyone here to get engaged. To get engaged first with your own views of Islam and the limit you set for yourself. How far you want to go. So we discounted much of Islam by saying, I am not the prophet. Whenever reminded, the prophet used to do this, I am not the prophet. So we discounted this one level. And then we discounted the aspiration to act like the Sahaba. Right? So we say, I am not a Sahabi. Oh, Abu Bakr used to do, he is a companion, he is Abu Bakr. I am not Abu Bakr, I am not Umar. So we discounted this. So when we go to the next generation, we say, no, those are the early Salaf. Those were close, very close to the Prophet. So where is our level now? Because it went so low, now what we want and wish us and our children to be is Steve Hawking. Where is a Muslim Einstein? Right? Where is this? So now we want to just be like Western noted heroes, achievers, because we lost sight of our own. We refused our role models. So what now we are looking at is the role models that are fit for the Western society, and they are great models. I'm not criticizing any of them. But where are they in their relationship to Allah? Because in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ إِنَّ الْخَاسِرِينَ الَّذِينَ خَسِرُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَهْلِيهِمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Say, O Muhammad, that the true losers are those who lose themselves and their families on the day of judgment. These are the real losers. There is no way we could fix it when we get there. We have to fix it here. We have one chance at life, one chance at raising your children on the straight path, one chance for a certain generation to stand up and say, enough is enough. We have to empower our community, if not the current generation, at least the following generation. You see, the critical issue is our physical survival is now at stake. If you've not heard it, let me give you the real bad news. In Britain, an unknown group started to circulate a letter in which they invite each other to do what? To help Muslim immigrants settle, to help Muslim immigrants learn English, learn the culture, to integrate them, to help them adjust to the school system. No. The slogan of the letter is, hurt a Muslim day. Did you hear it? Hurt a Muslim day on April 3rd, which is 3 days from now. And they list activities to achieve this. If you punch a Muslim, you get this many points. If you snatch a scarf from a girl, you get this many points. If you insult a Muslim, you do get this much points. If you kill a Muslim, if you bomb a mosque, this is as evil as it can get. If these people felt threatened by the law as a reaction to their behavior, they wouldn't have taken the Muslim community for a scapegoat. They have pain with their own economy because of the Brexit. They have pain in their social system because the family in the West, in general, is not likely to give them the number of children even that they need to survive as a generation. The West is threatened. The studies show that unless the rate of birth is at least 1.9, you cannot keep and maintain the economic prosperity you have. You cannot even support your elder generation. You cannot generate enough economy. That's why Europe is in a bind. They don't like immigrants' culture, but they like immigrants' labor, because the Middle East is exporting youth who are willing to risk their life in the Mediterranean Sea, risking to drown their children and their family, fleeing from despotic regimes, going to places that hate their culture but welcome their hands to support the economy. So the people are frustrated, but they are more frustrated with, of course, the few who are either throwing bullets or guns or explosions in their towns. This is a reality we cannot overlook. So they get their anger on us, the masses of Muslims, with random acts of violence just to vent their anger. I hope that we Muslims in America will take that issue seriously. We should take this issue seriously. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ادفع بالتي هي أحسن. Push back in the best of ways. And the best of ways are the things that you could do to make the situation less conflicting and less troublesome for everybody. To de-escalate the tension and to take care of the conflict. And our only way to deal with this is da'wah. Reach out to people. Let them know who you are. Who is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? They call him names. You know it. All of us know what names they are calling Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because of ignorance and misinformation and disinformation, they hate us for following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because their image of the Prophet is misconstrued. It is not the right image. Who is going to give them the right information? Somebody has to move. We should never like our comfort zone anymore than children like to play all the time. I will repeat this. We should look at sitting in our comfort zone like children who want to play 24/7. Play, eat, and sleep. Sleep, eat, and play. The three. And keep recycling them. Our ummah deserves better from us. Our ummah deserves people who see the mission of being a Muslim, especially in this country, as much bigger than filling a mosque, or filling a lecture hall, or saying the loudest takbir in the world. This is not going to get us anywhere unless we know what prayer is intended to do. Prayer is intended to inspire us to stand up for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to stand up for justice, to stand up against racism, nationalism, and all the ism that have created and brought havoc on our world from east to west, north to south. We don't have to treat the world one country at a time. All what we need to do is to spread Islam and teach Islam to our neighbors, yes, one person at a time. It's enough. 1.6 billion, if every one of us, if half of us would teach only one person each, you will increase the number 50%. And take a whole year to guide one person. I believe this is not a big task. Much less, what is wrong with us not teaching our own children what is great about Islam? I attended a science fair in one of the schools here in Stirling, and mashallah, kids are like sponges. They are willing to learn and teach. Amazing. And when I asked the parents what they know, they did not know as much as their children learned from their teacher. Their teacher guided them to do a research about the Quran and science. So each two kids would do a research on one subject and come up with a science display board to show the audience what Allah says about mountains, what Allah says about stars, about the planets, about the growing of or the development of the fetus in the mother's womb, and many, many other issues. I challenge any child sitting here or any child of ours who are at home to match those kids who are fifth, sixth, and seventh graders. Their presentations were great, and their reasoning was amazing. They were amazing. Brothers, do not waste the life of your children by letting them pick the ashes from what is left that they learn in the school. Let them focus on the science that helps them grow their faith and their belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not the science that tells them your book is wrong, your book is wrong, your prophet is wrong. Please, give your children time. Give your children knowledge. Give your children faith. Give your children the Quran. Teach your children to do Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi anil Munkar in their own small children community. To help each other straighten up. Help your children to resolve conflict so that they are not firecrackers, they are peacemakers. Many of us complain about the noise the children have. They are always fighting, fighting, fighting. Teach them how to resolve conflict in a peaceful way. Teach them how to communicate their ideas, how to communicate their feeling, their anger, their happiness, what they want, without crying or fighting. That's how you raise a straight person whose head is bigger than his body. Most of our children have bodies, but they don't have the brains because those brains are not full of knowledge that benefits. عِلْمٌ يُنْتَفَعُ بِهِ. How could they then grow up to be وَلَدٌ صَالِحٌ يَدْعُو لَهُ. Salih is the key word. So if you want your children to pray for you, you better want them to be righteous than to make prayer for you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide our children and educate them and help us teach them and help us raise them up as the greater generation. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وبعد. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to ask his companions some questions from time to time. So one day he asked them, who visited a sick person today? Who fasted today? Who walked with a janazah until he got the janazah to the cemetery? So today I'm going to ask you a question. Who among all of us here is willing to spend an hour a day for the sake of his or her children? Can I see a show of hands? An hour a day. Can I still see the show of hands? That's about 10%. Who is willing to spend 2 hours a week? 2 hours a week. If you raise your hand first, keep it down. Who wants to spend 1 hour a week to raise Muslim children at your own home? One and a half? 2.5? Can we make them 3? Just half. You see, it looks laughable. Do you know whom we are laughing at? We are laughing at ourselves. Thank you. You know the tomato you buy in the market? Do you know why you pay money for it? Because somebody worked to grow it, to make sure it's healthy, and somebody brought it to you in the supermarket, and somebody is manning the store so that you can get what you want, which means it did not grow in the wild. Somebody grew these tomatoes in a farm. Our ummah is not going to harvest what you do not plant. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم اشرح صدورنا لطاعتك. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا من الراشدين فضلا منك ونعمة. اللهم اشرح صدورنا لطاعتك. اللهم اشرح صدورنا لطاعتك واملأ قلوبنا بمحبتك. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم لا تجعل للشيطان على قلوبنا سبيلا ولا تجعل للشيطان على ذريتنا سبيلا ولا تجعل للشيطان على بيوتنا سبيلا. اللهم اجعل يومنا هذا خيرا من أمسنا واجعل غدنا خيرا من يومنا واجعل الجيل القادم خيرا من هذا الجيل يا رب العالمين. اللهم احفظ أولادنا. اللهم احفظ أولادنا. اللهم احفظ أولادنا. ربنا عليك توكلنا وإليك أنبنا وإليك المصير. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فستذكرون ما أقول لكم وأفوض أمري إلى الله إن الله بصير بالعباد. أقم الصلاة.